pleasure that we are commencing our fourth day. This session is on oximetry, cardiac output shunt calculations, artifacts, errors, assumptions, calculation of vascular resistances, and then we are now going on in the session two towards decision on operability with respect to individual specific lesions. I hope the audio is appropriate.
It's okay, sir. That's it. If there is a disturbance, then I will switch off the video at that end, sir.
Okay, thank you. So today's session is going to be decision making on operability and specific individual lesions will be targeted. Just before that, one slide about what we saw yesterday. We started with VO2 calculations, the basic principles, and how in a lab we can use the Lafarge equation or some other similar equations. What is arteriovenous oxygen extraction? How to calculate cardiac output based on VO2 and arteriovenous oxygen difference? Calculate QP, QES, effective pulmonary blood flow, which is called QEP, and from that, how to calculate left-right shunt and right-to-left shunt? How to calculate systemic and pulmonary vascular resistances? What are the errors in oximetry and in the calculations? When we should use assumed values rather than the true measured values, and when we should use measured value rather than assumed value. A couple of indices that are used in the calculation is transpulmonary gradient and diastolic pulmonary gradient. Transpulmonary gradient is otherwise the numerator of pulmonary vascular resistance. So it is pulmonary artery mean minus pulmonary vein mean, and it is the key indicator of pulmonary vascular resistance. PVRI value of more than three Wood units is the definition for diagnosis of idiopathic PAH. However, we need to remember that in many of the post-tricuspid shunts, especially large shunts, the PA mean will be substantially high. So, the transpulmonary gradient may be quite high in patients who are having large post-tricuspid shunts, especially in older age group. So some alternative indicators are also being considered, like diastolic pulmonary gradient, which is PA diastolic pressure minus PV mean. PA diastolic pressure is normally equal to PV mean. And so if the PA diastolic pressure is higher and higher, more than the PV mean, that is a direct indicator of precapillary arteriolar spasm or precapillary arteriolar disease. However, the caveat is, PA diastolic pressures can fall if there is significant PR. PR is inherent or induced in the cath lab by rigid catheters and sheaths, and hence we need to carefully assess the pulmonary artery diastolic pressure in the cath lab with PR by the rigid sheaths and rigid catheters that we are using. There is a question about, is not PVRI 3 Wood units meter square? Any PVRI, the moment that we say PVRI or SVRI, it is indexed. So it is already indexed. PVR and SVR are Wood units dot meter square. Whereas if it is cardiac output or QP, QS, QEP, it is liters per minute per meter square. So meet the body surface area goes to the denominator in QP, QS. And it sits on the numerator in PVRI. Diastolic pulmonary gradient of less than 3 millimeters of mercury is completely considered normal. a diastolic pulmonary gradient of more than 7 is considered significant elevation, and more than 12 is considered pathological. So now, why this diastolic pulmonary gradient and transpulmonary gradient? We all know that whenever there is an extremely large VSD or a very large PDA, if our aortic pressure is 120 over 80, it is very likely that PA pressure is also 120 over 80, if not 120 over 60. So both the mean pressure and diastolic pressure are going to be higher. However, when we are putting them for a vasodilator testing, either with oxygen or with some other agents, how much the pulmonary vascular resistance falls, how much the precapillary arteriole or spasm relaxes in order to find out the amount of fall in the PA mean and PA diastolic. And so acute vasodilator testing is done in shunts. The commonly used vasodilator is nitric oxide at 20 to 40 parts per million for 10 minutes. No need to administer for too long a period, because effect of nitric oxide is seen within a reasonably short period. Some centers like Boston Children's Hospital will directly recommend 80 parts per million to get the maximum response instantaneously. The practically, it is very difficult to exclude oxygen. You can give with compressed air, but it is very difficult to give, and hence very often in most of the labs, nitric oxide is combined with oxygen. However, whenever we are calculating the QPQS, oxygen avoidance is desired. The reason being, the moment we start giving oxygen, dissolved oxygen goes up, and so we need to factor in the entire dissolved oxygen into the calculations, especially PV, aorta, we need to factor in, where the dissolved oxygen can go to very high levels. In some of the healthy lungs, PO2 in the pulmonary veins can even go to 500 millimeters of mercury. So dissolved oxygen needs to be factored. So use of oxygen will narrow the PV to PA difference and thereby lead to overestimation of the QP. And hence, by and large, calculations without oxygen is preferred. And so most of the decision is taken on the basal data. In nitric oxide plus oxygen, we primarily look more and more at what is the pressure fall rather than the quantum of QP elevation. The criteria were initially laid down for acute vasodilator testing primarily for idiopathic PAH and other causes of pulmonary arterial hypertension. So there is a question about, should we continue for 10 minutes and then start collecting the samples? Yes, 10 minutes of time of nitric oxide is given, and following 10 minutes, then you start collecting the samples. And during the collection of samples, you continue to run nitric oxide till the last sample is taken out. On room air, should we include dissolved oxygen from the calculations? Yesterday, we were doing a demo calculation. The normal room air pulmonary vein and O2 can go to 100. So 0.03 into 100 will add 3. So normally the oxygen content of an arterial blood and pulmonary venous blood is very often 200 ml per liter, and the amount of addition will be 200 will become 203. So it is not very important to factor in dissolved oxygen in room air calculations at all. Just to make everybody understand, room air means 21% oxygen in room air. 21% of 760 millimeters of mercury. 760 millimeters of mercury is the atmospheric pressure. 21% of 760 is approximately 160. So 160 millimeters of mercury is the PO2 in room air. And as this 160 starts going in into our alveoli, entire nasal, tracheal, bronchial airway, where it mixes with two contaminants. Number one contaminant is carbon dioxide. Number two contaminant is water vapor. Water vapor is inherently part of our tracheobronchial lumen, and hence combined effect of water vapor plus carbon dioxide will reduce the PO2 to 110 millimeters of mercury at the level of alveolus. Whenever the alveolar epithelium is very efficient, this 110 will be transmitted to pulmonary vein, so pulmonary vein will be 110. And as this pulmonary vein 110 PO2 keeps coming towards the aorta, it is getting diluted by the bronchial veins that drain into the pulmonary vein and the Tabacian veins that drain into the left ventricle. Thereby, aorta maximum will be 100 millimeters of mercury in room air. So if we are using dissolved oxygen in room air calculations, in the ascending aorta, the maximum PO2 will be 100 millimeters of mercury. And so if you factor in 0.03 into 100, you will get 3. So the entire oxygen content from normally what is 200 ml per liter will just go up 203 ml per liter. And so the amount of elevation by dissolved oxygen is negligible. And when it comes to the venous side, most of the venous side, the saturations are around 75 and the PO2 is 35. So 35 into 0.03 is 1. And hence, in the oxygen content on the venous side, normally it is about 150 ml per liter. 150 will become 151, just one increase. So that's again negligible. So it is not important to consider dissolved oxygen in room air at all. In centers who don't have facilities for nitric oxide, oxygen is the most, the acceptable option. So coming to the acute vasodilator testing response, till 2005, primarily this was used for idiopathic pulmonary arterial hypertension. So Robin Bast criteria way back in 1986 declared that an acute vasodilator test response, positive responder means mean PA pressure reduced by 20% from the baseline without any change in cardiac output. Then came the Rich criteria in 1992. All these are named after the person who gave the criteria. Bast, Rich, Sidbon are all the persons who gave the criteria. In 1992, it was the Rich criteria which told the mean PA should reduce by more than 20% and the PVR should also reduce by 20%. Sidbon criteria in 2005 gave a definition of PA mean absolute value reducing by 10 millimeters of mercury and absolute PA mean pressure should fall less than 40 millimeters of mercury. Until this time, it was primarily used for idiopathic pulmonary arterial hypertension, mostly in adults. People started using more and more in children and in cardiac shunts. So the recent European Pulmonary Vascular Disease Network has given criteria that in idiopathic pulmonary arterial hypertension, pulmonary artery mean pressure reduction more than 20% and PVR by SVR ratio less than 0.4 is considered as a positive response in idiopathic PAH, whereas in shunt lesions, 20% or in any congenital heart disease associated PAH, it is 20% fall in PVR, 20% fall in PVR-SVR ratio, absolute PVRI falling less than 6 wood units meter square, absolute PVR-SVR less than 0.3 ratio, and PA diastolic pressure to aortic diastolic pressure ratio less than 0.4. So this is the recent 2016 guidelines by the European Pulmonary Vascular Disease Network. Which agent should be given in children for acute vasodilator testing? We already saw in adults with idiopathic pulmonary arterial hypertension, it is nitric oxide or epoprostenol or adenosine. Whereas in children, nitric oxide is the preferred agent, 20 to 40 parts per million. Some people go to 80 parts per million in order to get the maximum response for 10 minutes. You can also give nebulized iloprost 0.3 to 0.5 microgram per kg over 15 minutes, or puffs of treprostinil, metered dose inhaler puffs of treprostinil, 3 to 6 puffs, which will deliver 18 to 36 micrograms, and wait for about 10 minutes and then take the samples. In special situations, the patient may be intubated, ventilator is too sick, and it will not be possible to incorporate these three into the ventilatory circuit. In such cases, in children, epoprostenol or iloprost infusions are accepted. Epoprostenol at 2 to 10 nanograms per kg per minute with progressive 2 nanogram increments, or iloprost infusion 0.5 to 2 nanogram per kilogram per minute for 10 minutes. And what is not recommended is use of adenosine in children. Do we need to satisfy all the criteria that we gave? No. We will go back. We need to, these are all the criteria that are given for vasodilator response, and we need to use lots of clinical discretion. None of these are gold standard rules. These are all based on limited studies that has been done on very few patients and largely given a recommendation as level of evidence C. And hence, we need to factor in all these numbers and then take a decision individually. Advanced testing that are done on pulmonary hypertension in research laboratories are pulmonary arterial endothelial function, which is basically selective catheterization of the branch pulmonary artery. Infuse acetylcholine 10^-6 moles and check the flow with flow wire and check the pressure with end hole catheters. Or identify circulating endothelial progenitor cells. These are all advanced endothelial function studies, but practically we will be doing basal study and nitric oxide study. There is a question about whether IV sildenafil is useful. Yes, IV sildenafil is also an acceptable agent for vasodilator testing in idiopathic pulmonary arterial hypertension. Validations are not given for congenital heart diseases with shunt lesions, and hence, currently, it is better to use one of the agents that we had specified. Oxygen is also a reliable agent in the absence of nitric oxide or any other agent in your cath lab. Coming to now, we are entering into specific clinical situations. So our aim will be to discuss each and every lesion, identify the methods specific to these lesions and the fallacies specific to these lesions. We will be spending more time on lesions where we commonly do catheterization and less time on lesions where we do not commonly do catheterization. Shunts are common reasons for doing catheterization. Just a recap, because there were a few questions that came up yesterday. Shunts are basically decided for operability based on criteria that are not actually cardiac catheterization. Most of the time, this decision is taken in the clinic based on variety of factors. Any child with symptom of large shunt and heart failure, younger age, features of hyperkinetic circulation with large heart, flow diastolic murmurs across the atrioventricular valves, cardiomegaly and plethora on the chest X-ray, appropriate chamber enlargement on the ECG, right side for pre-tricuspid lesions and left side for post-tricuspid lesions, volume overload and shunt pattern on the echocardiogram, pulse oximeter at rest and oxygen saturation on provocation. A few questions. How do we deliver 100% oxygen in the cath lab? Oxygen is commonly delivered in the cath lab using nasal prongs or with mask. Higher the flow, higher the amount of FiO2. Through a mask or nasal prongs, the maximum amount of FiO2 that you can reach will be anywhere varying between 40 to 70% depending on the amount of flow rate, and hence try to give the maximum flow rate that is acceptable in order to get the maximum amount of oxygen delivered. when we call 100% oxygen, only intubated patients with a cuffed tube where the ventilator will deliver FiO2 of 100%, you will be able to maintain 100%. Otherwise, most of the time when we are using oxygen through mask or nasal prongs, the maximum that we'll be able to deliver will be anywhere varying from 40 to 70 depending on the flow rate. Adenosine protocol is not recommended for children, but adenosine protocol in adults with idiopathic PAH is starting with 50 microgram per kg per minute and going up to 300 microgram per kg per minute as an infusion. Something similar to what you will be using in testing for coronary flow reserve. BiPAP is not a must for delivering oxygen. Oxygen can be delivered by nasal prongs or by oxygen mask. In introducing BiPAP will create a positive airway pressure, thereby alter your recordings. It will produce a small increase in the intrathoracic pressure, and intrathoracic pressure increase will result in marginal elevation of the pressures. So now let us, the shunts are basically, the decision about surgery is based on largely clinical grounds with X-ray, ECG and echocardiogram. Coming to specific lesions, pre-tricuspid shunts. I divide this pre-tricuspid shunts, the questions that will come to us, into six categories. The first category, very, very early presentation in infancy. What is early presentation in ASD? Obviously, primum defects and associated mitral valve anomalies like mitral cleft with mitral regurgitation or additional mitral valve anomalies will result in larger shunts and can cause early presentation, easily understood. But in secondum ASDs, 5 to 6% of secondum ASD can have premature heart failure along with hyperkinetic PAH and marked growth failure. And this is especially aggravated in borderline inadequacy of the mitral valve and left ventricle. Infants who are having borderline inadequacy of mitral valve and left ventricle, associated especially with LSVC draining into a dilated coronary sinus. In order to understand the hemodynamics of an ASD, this is the pressure volume curve of an ASD in the fetus. In the fetus, right ventricle and left ventricle are working in synchrony. Both have got the same systolic pressures. Both contract together. So what is going up here is the isovolemic contraction. This is the systolic phase. This is the isovolemic relaxation, and this is the diastolic phase. So both ventricles contract in unison and has got a similar pattern of systole and diastole with similar pressures. The moment the baby is born, the clamping of the umbilical artery leads to cutoff of the low resistance placenta, which increases the systolic pressure. And the high afterload that is given by the systemic vascular resistance curtails the systole so that the systole is less in its volume. So basically the red goes into this direction because of elevation of systemic vascular resistance or afterload increase. What happens to the right ventricle? The pulmonary vascular resistance reduces. This fall in the pulmonary vascular resistance leads to reduction in the right ventricular pressures and an increased ability of the right ventricle to empty itself. So the right ventricle moves towards this. So the right ventricle has got lower afterload, which results in more efficient contraction of the right ventricle, and left ventricle has got a less sufficient contraction due to increase in the afterload. So this is immediate postnatal hemodynamics. Over a period of time, what happens? Right ventricular mass regresses. As the right ventricular mass regresses, the right ventricular compliance increases, and the right ventricle now starts accepting larger and larger volume at lower and lower pressures. So a much larger volume is accepted by the right ventricle, and the contractility is far more efficient without elevating significantly the right ventricular end diastolic pressure. The process of moving from this part, this is the immediate postnatal period, to late childhood, caused by progressive fall of the right ventricular muscle, actually preserves the right ventricular contractility, and that is why we call right ventricle is capable of tolerating volume overload far more efficiently. However, for some reason, if there is a premature, very early shift from this PV loop towards this PV loop, obviously the PV loop has to be accommodated at this level. And so a combination of factors leads to precipitous heart failure in a small number of infants. In a large proportion of infants, like 80 to 90% of the infants, the graduation from early postnatal period where there is a fall in the PVR to a late childhood where there is a regression of the right ventricular mass is a slow process with good adaptation. If there is a rapid shift, that leads to precipitous right heart failure. And in these patients, larger shunt is established too early. Inadequate regression of the PA musculature and inadequate regression of the RV musculature, RVEDP rises, RA pressure increases, and they present with heart failure. So a small 5% of the infants may present with early presenters in heart failure due to this maladaptation. Otherwise, most of the patients will tolerate the higher volume overload without elevation of pulmonary artery pressures at all. Again, as you track them over adulthood, 5 to 6% of the patients with ASD will develop pulmonary hypertension. It can be due to two reasons. Progressive RV stroke volume being elevated, that means RV is now ejecting larger stroke volume due to the larger left to right shunt, more efficient RV contractility caused by high pulmonary artery capacitance leads to higher and higher amount of right ventricular blood being pumped into the lungs. This leads to slow, continuous endothelial shear stretch causing progressive pulmonary vascular disease. Most of the patients have got a large ASD, what is defined as more than 2 centimeters, and most of these patients present beyond fourth decade. But some of them can be genetically predisposed. It is suspected that there is an element of idiopathic PAH, and most of the time this ASD is an innocent bystander. And often the ASD in these patients are less than 2 centimeters, and these patients may be younger. So ASD with pulmonary hypertension is seen in about 5 to 6% of the patients whom we are going to catheterize to assess the operability may fall into these two groups. And these are the differences between the two groups. PAH operability, in general, pulmonary artery systolic pressures more than 60 millimeters of mercury is a warning bell. It's very easy to obtain right ventricular systolic pressures in the echocardiographic laboratory by tricuspid regurgitation jet. And hence, a PA systolic pressure more than 60 millimeters of mercury is a warning bell. Resting shunt calculation in the cardiac catheterization laboratory and oximetry should demonstrate more than 1.5:1 shunt with PVRI less than 6 UD units for calling it operable in the resting state. The additional criteria that are given, there should not be a step down from pulmonary vein to aorta, or in other words, there should not be a systemic desaturation, and PVR to SVR ratio should be less than 0.3. The role of balloon occlusion in ASD is not well documented. In general, it is suspected that since the shunt is not post-tricuspid, balloon occlusion may not result in a reliable understanding of the hemodynamics. However, balloon occlusion will produce a reduction in the pulmonary artery pulse pressure. Let us understand what is this. Before balloon occlusion, the pulmonary artery pressure will have a wider pulse pressure with a high systolic, low diastolic, and mean pressure decided by the area under the curve. The reason being, higher right ventricular stroke volume will result in higher right ventricular systolic pressure, and that is transmitted to PA systolic pressure. So PA systolic pressure will be high. It is the diastolic pressure that decides what is the gradient between the PA diastole to PV mean. That is, this, the diastolic pressure is an indirect indicator of the level of precapillary pulmonary arteriolar spasm or disease. So when you do your balloon occlusion, there will be a reduction in the pulmonary artery pulse pressure. The PA systolic pressure will definitely come down in any patient with the AST, because right ventricular additional from left to right shunt RV stroke volume is 3 times higher than normal. And when you are reducing the RV stroke volume from 3 times to 1 time, there is definitely a reduction in the PA systolic pressure. So the pulse pressure will come down. And as you deflate the balloon, the PA pressure will go back to its normal. And what we need to carefully look at is the PA diastolic pressure. If the PA diastolic pressure is lower, with a PA diastolic pulmonary gradient less than 12 millimeters of mercury, it's a favorable sign. If it is higher, at least with an acute vasodilator, either oxygen or with nitric oxide, the PA diastolic pressure should fall down and the diastolic pulmonary gradient should come to less than 12. So in patients with PAH, acute vasodilator testing with oxygen or AVT is done if the basal diastolic pressure gradient is more than 12. And if the diastolic pulmonary gradient comes to less than 12 on acute vasodilator testing, they are likely to do well. In case they don't do, and you are satisfying some of the criteria on vasodilator test like PVR-SVR ratio, then you have an option of fenestrated patch closure or fenestrated device closure. Here comes the possibilities of treat and close, close and treat. These are all taken after clinical judgments. In general, desaturation in an ASD is considered a ominous sign because it may indicate severe pulmonary hypertension, high pulmonary vascular resistance, and the right to left shunt across the ASD. But we need to understand, desaturation in ASD can also be due to an unroofing of the coronary sinus, tricuspid regurgitation jet hitting the atrial septum and causing a right to left shunt, IVC straddling an inferior malalignant ASD, SVC straddling an SVC type of ASD, eustachian valve redirecting the flows. So these also can be causes of some amount of desaturation in ASD. The question that has been asked in the chat box, suppose you get idiopathic pulmonary hypertension with bystander ASD with RA-RV dilated, operability for closure. The way in which we identify whether it is an idiopathic pulmonary hypertension or whether it is an ASD who has developed pulmonary hypertension due to the longevity of the disease is by earlier presentation in an idiopathic PAH, number one. ASD sometimes being smaller than 2 centimeters, number two. And number three, lack of adequate response on vasodilator testing. Patients who are having ASDs with hyperkinetic pulmonary hypertension, often present in older age group, often have got a size of more than 2 centimeters and have got a higher chance of responding to vasodilator testing. So the causes of desaturation in ASD should be remembered. Then calculation of QP by QS. QP by QS of more than 1.5 is to 1 is considered for surgery. ASDs that are less than 1.5:1 are not considered normally for surgery or device closure. There are some exceptions to this rule. ASD after balloon pulmonary valvotomy for critical pulmonary stenosis or pulmonary atresia intact ventricular septum. In these patients, there will be an ASD which is not able to shunt more than 1.5:1 because of inherent RV diastolic dysfunction that persists in this patient for longer period of time. And these patients are still at a risk of developing paradoxical embolism. And so, at some point of time, reasonably earlier in their childhood, ASD is closed, which will promote a forward right ventricular inflow, thereby overhauling the right ventricle into a better shape. So closure of an ASD in earlier age group in these patients following balloon pulmonary valvotomy for critical PS or PAIVS may allow RV to be overhauled and made sufficient in volume over a period of time. ASDs in hypoplastic right ventricle and hypoplastic tricuspid valve. It's something like a corollary here. Here it is post balloon pulmonary valvotomy. Here is inherently hypoplastic RV or hypoplastic tricuspid valve. ASD in patients with Epstein's anomaly who are having minimal tricuspid regurgitation, if you are leaving behind a shunt of around 1.5, progressively ASDs can become larger and the shunt can become larger and larger, and the right ventricle can become larger and larger, leading to progressively more and more tricuspid regurgitation in future. ASD in paradoxical embolism, ASD in orthodeoxia platypnea syndromes are all well understood. Sometimes a small shunt ASD is closed in carcinoid syndrome in order to prevent transmission of the neurotransmitters from the right heart into the left heart, and thereby damaging the mitral and aortic valve also. Carcinoid syndrome is a neuroendocrine tumor arising from either the appendix or from the liver, or sometimes from other parts of the gastrointestinal system, which release certain neurotransmitters which progressively cause fibrosis and damage to the right-sided heart valves. Similarly, ASD with small shunts in patients on LVAD are also closed because LVAD will cause sucking out of the blood from the right atrium to left atrium whenever an ASD is present. So in such patients, even an ASD with QP by QS of less than 1.5 will be considered for closure. Common atrium versus ASD, we will discuss later. Common atrium is actually an admixture lesion and should not be considered as equivalent to ASD. There is a question about QP by QS of more than what is the cutoff for surgery in ASD, RVSD, RPD, or any shunt lesions. More than 1.5:1 is taken as the cutoff, and I am going to explain what is the sanctity of this 1.5 shortly in another few slides. The next question that comes to us in a pre-tricuspid shunt is it a dependent shunt or an obligatory shunt? An example of a pre-tricuspid dependent shunt is ASD. An example of a pre-tricuspid obligatory shunt is isolated PAPVC. Dependent shunt depends on PVR. So higher the PVR, less the shunt, lower the PVR, more the shunt. Obligatory shunt is always left to right and it is independent of PVR. Dependent shunt is not only dependent only on PVR, but dependent on ventricular function, ventricular EDP, and ventricular compliance as well. So in an adult with a left ventricular dysfunction caused due to older age, hypertension, diabetes, coronary artery disease, the shunt will increase. The shunt is less dependent on ventricular function, EDP, and compliance in PAPVC. Shunt may progressively increase or decrease with age in dependent shunt. So when you are having a progressive pulmonary vascular disease, shunt will keep on reducing. When you are having a progressive left ventricular disease, the shunt will keep on increasing. So shunt keeps increasing or decreasing. Obligatory shunt, shunt remains reasonably constant throughout the age. Dependent shunt, small to moderate sized asymptomatic ASD in childhood can result in congestive heart failure in old age due to left ventricular incompetence, left ventricular diastolic dysfunction. But small shunt in PAPVC is unlikely to increase with age. P PA-PVC is obligatory because PA-PVC is always left to right. ASD is dependent because ASD can become right to left if the PVR increases substantially. The terminology dependent means it can be left to right, it can be 1:1, it can be right to left. Whereas obligatory means it is always left to right. Peculiarity of pre-tricuspid shunts compared to post-tricuspid shunt is that pre-tricuspid shunt can become suprasystemic. Post-tricuspid shunts cannot become suprasystemic. Pre-tricuspid shunts can become suprasystemic. So a patient with ASD Eisenmenger can have subsystemic or systemic or suprasystemic PA pressure. Any combination can be there. How in some patients it becomes suprasystemic depends on the ability of the right ventricle to sustain the pressure in those patients. Coming to post-tricuspid shunt. So far what we are discussing was pre-tricuspid and now we are going to post-tricuspid shunt. Post-tricuspid shunts, there is a question about whether obligatory shunt can Eisenmengerize. Obligatory shunts can develop pulmonary vascular disease with PVRI going more than 8 Wood units. However, they cannot cause a right to left shunt. Eisenmenger syndrome is defined as a shunt lesion where there is a reversal from initial left to right to either bidirectional or right to left shunt, causing systemic desaturation, cyanosis, hypoxia, and such a thing cannot happen in isolated PAPVC. So it is not called as isolated PAPVC with Eisenmenger syndrome. It is called isolated PAPVC with pulmonary vascular obstructive disease. There is another question. Large ASD with LV diastolic dysfunction with severe pulmonary hypertension. Whenever there is a large ASD with LV diastolic dysfunction, progressively the shunt will keep on increasing. So the QP by QS will keep on increasing. The QP by QS which increases progressively over age will result in hyperkinetic PAH. This is not pulmonary vascular disease. This is hyperkinetic PAH. So when we are calculating the QP by QS, the QP by QS will be 3:1 or 3.5:1. And thereby the PVRI will not go to very, very high numbers. PVRI will not go to more than 8 Wood units. So whenever you are having a patient with large ASD with LV diastolic dysfunction and severe pulmonary hypertension, the primary pathology is on the LV and it is the higher LVED that is driving the larger shunt and hence the attention is given primarily for the left ventricle. About closing or not to close, we had already discussed at depth during the hemodynamic sessions in the earlier session. Now coming to ventricular septal defect, I want you to pay some concentration at this particular point. Fetal PVR falls after birth in a large VSD, we all know. Increasing SVR and falling PVR establishes the left to right shunt in a VSD at 4 to 6 weeks of age. Let us assume that the left ventricle is shunting 25% of its blood through the VSD into the right ventricle. The QP by QS is approximately 1.3:1. If the left ventricle is pumping half of the blood that it is containing into the VSD, the QP by QS is 2:1. If the left ventricle is shunting almost 75% of the blood, that means 3/4 of the blood that it is having into the VSD, the QP by QS is 4:1. I'm going to draw some cartoons to make people understand. This is the left ventricle. This is the VSD. This left ventricle is receiving 4 liters of blood. It is pumping 3 liters into the aorta and 1 liter through the VSD. So it is pumping 25% of its stroke volume into the VSD. This results in this 3 liters that is going into the aorta comes back into the tricuspid valve and this 3 liters gets added to this 1 liter. So pulmonary outflow carries 4 liters, aortic outflow carries 3 liters. So QP by QS is 1.3:1. So 25% of blood of the LV stroke volume is directed through the VSD. It gives 1.3:1 shunt. Let us assume 50% blood is transmitted. I have an aortic outflow of 3 liters. So I am going to be getting 6 liters inside. So 6 liters comes into the left ventricle, into this volume overloaded left ventricle. Half of the blood is shunted. Half of the blood goes into the aorta. Half of the blood, when it is shunted, 3 liters goes to the other side. And so the pulmonary outflow now carries 6 liters and aortic outflow carries 3 liters. QP by QS is 2:1. When I say QP by QS is 2:1, half of the left ventricular blood is actually entering the right ventricle. Taking further, the left ventricle is pumping 75% of the blood through the VSD. A large amount of the blood actually goes only through the VSD and only a small amount goes to the aorta. 75% goes. So the aortic outflow is 3 liters. The inflow is 12 liters. Of the 12 liters, majority of the blood is going to the right, and this will cause the QP by QS of 4:1. We need to remember, LV has to pump 75% of its blood to the right side and only 25% of the blood towards the aorta to make a QP by QS of 4:1. So whenever some calculations are made and somebody tells QP by QS of 7:1, understand this. More than 3:1 or more than 4:1, all the calculations go wrong because we are now working at the highest levels of PV and PA saturations. An example of PV saturation being 99 and PA saturation being 97 will give a QP by QS of 6:1, 7:1. And at that level, the accuracy of fixed cardiac output is lost. Fixed calculations work well when the arteriovenous saturation difference, content difference is very high. So fixed principle accuracy reduces when the difference between PV and PA is very small. So remember, it makes sense to say at the end of your calculation, if the QP by QS, if you are getting a calculation of more than 4:1, then just write it as more than 4:1 and don't specify 7:1, 8:1. It doesn't make sense because even for 4:1, the left ventricle is pumping 75% of the blood into the right ventricle and only 25% into the aorta. So there is a question by some person, why is 1 liter? This is completely just sheer mathematics. Just keep understanding. 4 liters of blood comes into the left ventricle because this patient is having a VSD with a higher pulmonary venous return. I'm keeping the 3 liters constant, the cardiac output constant in all these three situations. If I have to pump left ventricle 3 liters into the aorta with an VSD, still allowing 25% left right, 1 liter has to go in here. And that gives QP by QS of 1.33. The reason why I'm putting this cartoon, we were previously discussing the sanctity of the number QP by QS of more than 1.5:1. If 33% of the LV blood is pumped through the VSD, the QP by QS is 1.5:1. That means if the left ventricle is diverting 1/3 of the blood towards the right, or for that matter, any cardiac chamber on the left side is diverting 1/3 of the blood to the other chamber, that is called QP by QS of 1.5:1. And this is the number above which it is considered it is better to operate, below which it is considered that body will be accepting that limited amount of volume overload. So we are allowing up to 33% of a chamber blood to cross over to the other side without doing any intervention. And once it crosses 33%, the shunt ratio, the shunt amount is more than 33% from this chamber, then the QP by QS goes more than 1.5:1. And hence, this is the sanctity of the number. Oximetry in a ventricular septal defect, superior vena cava saturation should be recorded well above the right atrium at the level of junction of the innominate vein to avoid streaming either from a stretched PFO or from tricuspid regurgitation. Ideally speaking, pulmonary veins should be sampled in patients with VSD for operability testing, even with a septal puncture. The reason being, pulmonary vein desaturation is important to document. Patients with VSD with high pulmonary blood flow will have a milder degree of alveolar and interstitial edema that causes a milder degree of pulmonary vein desaturation, and hence simultaneous pulmonary vein and aortic sampling will be excluding a right to left anatomical shunt through the VSD. If the pulmonary vein itself is low, that means the desaturation that you are getting in the aorta is physiological due to lung hypoventilation or lung pathology rather than anatomical at the level of VSD. And hence, it is useful to always sample pulmonary vein in a post-tricuspid shunt lesion where you are deciding about operability. PA sample should be taken as far at the hilum to allow a good mixing. Now, whenever there is a large AS, large post-tricuspid shunt lesions, extremely large, the PA and aorta will be similar because the same ventricle is ejecting together. And so both the chambers should have same systolic pressure. And patients whom we are going to do the operability testing are those who are having higher vascular resistance, and hence most of the time the diastolic pressures are matching. Whenever we are recording simultaneous aortic and pulmonary artery pressures, I'll just go back to this slide. This pressure tracing should be recorded with ascending aorta and main pulmonary artery, because if you take from the femoral artery, there will be a peripheral systolic amplification and you will not be able to appreciate the systolic equivalence. So you need to take at the level of ascending aorta and main pulmonary artery. Branch pulmonary arteries in smaller babies can show physiological PA stenosis with mild gradients, and hence PA pressures are taken at main pulmonary artery and ascending aorta. Very high flows across the pulmonary valve can produce some venturi effect and can produce a very subtle fall in the PA systolic pressure. We need to understand that. So in patients with very large VSD also, there can be a mild difference of the PA systolic. PA systolic can slightly be lower. It is not due to the true pressure being low. It is because of the flow turbulence that has happened because of higher flow through the pulmonary valve, which creates a venturi effect. The last phenomenon, end pressure artifact, is due to end hole in the pulmonary artery facing away from the direction of flows. And so that also is another factor. So all these four factors can result in pulmonary artery systolic pressure 3 or 4 millimeters of mercury less than the aortic systolic pressure. We need to understand. Concentrate on the diastolic pulmonary gradient. What is the diastolic pressure of the pulmonary? Simultaneously, aorta and pulmonary artery. The diastolic pulmonary artery pressures between aorta and pulmonary artery. PA diastolic by aortic diastolic less than 0.4 is a good sign of operability. That means PA diastolic going extremely low. However, many patients in whom we do a cardiac catheterization for assessing operability are patients who are already sort of borderline, and hence very often in clinical practice, you will find PA diastolic to aortic diastolic almost equal, or the ratio is only around 0.8 to 0.9. But what is needed is a PA diastolic to aortic diastolic pressure ratio of more than 0.4. And this is obtained by allowing the pulmonary arterioles to relax by doing vasodilator testing. So to decide on operability in such cases, we do vasodilator testing. If there is no response to vasodilator testing, that means the PA pressures remain the same with same mean and same diastolic pressure, the arteriolar obstruction is fixed it is no longer reactive. However, what we will normally see will be a reactive bed, and the reactive bed will cause PA diastolic pressures to fall significantly, and now PA diastolic to aortic diastolic will separate out. In VSD, left ventricle and right ventricle are in free communication. So left ventricle and right ventricular systolic pressures are the same. In systole, both semilunar valves are open. So RV pressure, PA pressure is the same. LV pressure, aortic pressure is the same. So all the four systolic pressures are same. And so there is a systolic equalization. All four chambers will have same systolic pressure. But diastolic pressure will separate out. So diastolic pressure ratio will tell us, is this patient becoming operable? This is a quick sign. Of course, for calculations, you will calculate the PA mean, aortic mean, take the samples, do the calculations, and finally arrive at what is the PVR-SVR ratio and what is the QPQS. However, the earliest sign that you are going to get the moment you have started the vasodilator, which can be either oxygen or nitric oxide, is the fall in the PA diastolic pressure in relation to aortic diastolic pressure. There are some more questions that has come up. MPA pressure will give VIP artifact. Yes, we need to factor in all the various types of artifact. VIP artifact is an artifact that is caused especially with a balloon flotation catheter in the pulmonary artery, which keeps pumping the catheter along with each systole towards the PA and thereby causing actually an increase. End pressure artifact is the catheter is facing away from pulmonary artery flow, so actually the pressure will reduce. In preterm PDA, large VSD will also present early as immature myocardium and sympathetic. Yes, every patient, whoever is premature, we will come to it a little while later. In one of the factors that determines the earlier fall of pulmonary vascular resistance is prematurity. In many cases, systolic and diastolic don't change, but QP increases significantly. Are they inoperable? In fact, this is the reason why multiple factors are taken into consideration. If your diastolic pressure falls, thereby pulling the mean pressure, the PVR-SVR ratio will fall. So the PVR by SVR criteria will become eligible. However, if the systolic and diastolic pressure remains the same in spite of vasodilator, but your QP by QS increases to 3 to 4 fold, then the PVR, absolute PVR number will fall. And if the absolute PVR number is falling less than 6 wood units, that is also considered operability. So that is one of the reasons why multiple indices are given, and we need to take individualized decisions rather than going by one criteria. So the various criteria that has been given, PVR, absolute PVR index less than 6, PVR by SVR ratio less than 0.3, 20% reduction in PVRI from the baseline, 20% reduction in PVR-SVR ratio from baseline, PA diastolic pressure to aortic diastolic pressure. One particular patient will not fit into all the 5 criteria. So you need to take this into consideration. Significant PR secondary to catheter may cause PA diastolic drop. We had already described this very clearly. You need to use after catheters, and you need to factor in the element of pulmonary regurgitation before considering these pressure hemodynamics. We had discussed this both in the hemodynamic class earlier as well as in the yesterday's session as well. On the contrary, in a post-semilunar valve lesion like in a PDA, we already had identified that there is a diastolic equalization and systolic pressure is high on vasodilator testing. The reason being, in PDA, PA and aorta communicate to each other in diastole, so there is no diastolic difference. But when the PVR falls to allow a high QP, the increased left atrial return goes through the increased left ventricular stroke volume, thereby causing transient higher aortic systolic pressure. This is called as the impulse gradient. Impulse gradient is a larger left ventricular stroke volume will result in larger aortic pressure instantaneously. This is something equivalent to the impulse gradient that you see in hypertrophic cardiomyopathies, wherein there is a spike and dome pattern. The spike is caused by impulse gradient. So that is what is called impulse gradient. So operability in large PDA, obviously in a large PDA, both the diastolic should come down. So operability in large PDA will be indicated by fall in the PA diastolic pressure. Sometimes it may not fall alone. It has to fall with aorta as well in a large PDA on vasodilator testing. So an indirect evidence will be a large pulse pressure of the aorta and pulmonary artery during vasodilator testing. So a patient who is having a PDA with a large bounding pulse is considered operable. A patient with a large PDA who is not having a large bounding pulse is the one that will go into the cardiac catheterization lab for vasodilator testing. And during the vasodilator testing, if you are getting a fall of the PA diastolic together with aortic diastolic, now you have created a large pulse pressure for the aorta, and thereby this gives a clinical sign of operability. So you look at the diastolic pressures, how much it falls. Now, based on these two, three diagrams that we saw, the different times when patient develops Eisenmenger, in AP window and PDA, the pulmonary artery and aorta are together in communication. So the pulmonary artery faces systolic, diastolic mean pressure of the aorta continuously throughout the cardiac cycle. So this high amount of PA pressure leads to more shear stress and more circumferential vessel stretch, more damage to the pulmonary arterioles, resulting in very early changes. So AP window and PDA will cause earlier pulmonary vascular disease than VSD. The reason is VSD exposes pulmonary artery to systemic pressures only during systole, whereas AP window and PDA will expose the pulmonary artery to systemic pressure both in systole and diastole. Between AP window and PDA, AP window has no resistance at all because it is a window. There is no length. So because there is no resistance, the presentation is far earlier. It's very unlikely to find out a large AP window beyond 2 years who will remain operable. PDA is like a tube. So the long tube, the length of the tube offers some resistance. So PDA develops Eisenmenger sometimes little later, maybe in second decade. So between AP window and PDA, AP window will present with pulmonary vascular disease earlier. PDA will present with pulmonary vascular disease later. But in general, AP window and PDA will present with high vascular resistance in much earlier than VSD. There is a question about when is the time VSD Eisenmengerizes. The pathology will start by the time the child is 2 years or 2.5 years, but the definition of Eisenmenger syndrome is when the shunt reverses from initially left to right to bidirectional or right to left, thereby causing systemic hypoxia and clinically detectable cyanosis. And that will happen much later. In AP window, that happens often by the end of first decade. In PDA, that happens somewhere around end of second decade. In VSD, it happens often by third decade. So we are not talking about the pathology of pulmonary vascular disease at what age it starts. We are talking about the clinical presentation of Eisenmenger syndrome or clinical occurrence of cyanosis. That is usually by around third decade. The reason being, unlike AP window and PDA, in VSD, pulmonary artery faces systemic pressures only in systole, and during diastole, it is protected by closure of the pulmonary valve and aortic valve. The last is ASD because it is a slow progressive volume overload leading to delayed onset. what we are introducing here is basically a concept. We are not going by absolute number. There will be one particular child who will develop an Eisenmenger syndrome and show clinical cyanosis at 6 years of age with a VSD. There may be one child who is 10 or 11 years with AP window who is still not showing clinical cyanosis. But by and large, majority of the AP window will present with Eisenmenger syndrome by first decade, PDA somewhere around second decade, VSD somewhere around third decade, and ASD somewhere around fourth decade. This is for basic understanding rather than individually deciphering out and saying, I have a patient who is having Eisenmenger syndrome at 6 years of age, and definitely this should be only AP window and it is not VSD. It is to understand the concepts. Pulmonary vascular resistance gets elevated due to varieties of confounders. The confounders can be airway obstruction, bronchopneumonia, reactive airway disease, bronchopulmonary dysplasia in babies who are born premature, significant anemia or polycythemia, hypothyroidism, vitamin B1 deficiency, or any chronic lung pathology. I'll show some examples of how clinical operability decisions may vary. A 36-year-old lady presents with a moderate-sized VSD measuring 13 millimeter when her aortic annulus was 18 millimeter. The IV gradient was 36 millimeters of mercury. RV systolic pressure by TRZ was 90 millimeters of mercury. She has got only 91% room air saturation. She is definitely left to right shunting because IV gradient is 36, but oxygen saturation is 91. The comorbidity is there is an endobronchial right lower lobe mass causing a right lower lobe collapse. You can see the volume loss on the right side hemithorax on the axial slice and the coronal slice. When you take the patient into the catheterization laboratory to assess what is the contribution of this markedly elevated pulmonary artery pressure, 90 RV systolic pressure, is it due to hypoxia caused by the lungs? Or is it due to a moderate sized VSD? What is the individual, or is it the hypoxia caused by the lung pathology causing this RV systolic pressure? So you take into the cath lab, you get the aortic and pulmonary artery simultaneous pressures. And now what we are observing is the PA diastolic pressure is almost around 40 millimeters of mercury. See, this is the underdamping. So these sharp deflections at the end of diastole, a PA diastolic pressure has to merge with the upstroke rather than having a sharp dip. So this is an underdamping. So the PA diastolic pressure is somewhere around 40 millimeters and aortic diastolic pressure is somewhere around 65 millimeters of mercury. Let us assess what is the shunt. Superior and inferior vena cava had a saturation of around 73 to 76. But it increases to 78 in pulmonary artery. The quantum of step up is very minimal. It's hardly about 4 to 5 millimeters of mercury maximum. Obviously, the pulmonary veins are having a disease. The left lower pulmonary vein, which is the non-diseased part, is showing 94.7%. Right upper pulmonary vein, again, which is a relatively non-diseased part, is 92.4%. And the aorta is 91.7. We clearly know that there is no left right shunt because there is an IV gradient of 36 millimeters of mercury. So it is the pulmonary vein desaturation that is causing this aortic desaturation. The shunt is negligible. The QP by QS is 1.2:1. The calculated PVR index is 10.7. The PVR-SVR ratio is almost 0.5. So what is the inference? The quantum of shunt through the VSD is negligible because it is only 1.2:1. So is it all due to only hypoxia? So hypoxia will get reversed if you supplement oxygen. So you supplement oxygen. On oxygen, what you are identifying, the SVC and IVC becomes 76 and 84, PA becomes 85, and the mixed venous to PA step up now marginally goes up. The step up is now somewhere around 7% saturation increase. Now you try to analyze the diseased lung also. The right lower pulmonary vein is the diseased lung where in spite of oxygen, the saturation is quite low. The saturation is only 88% with a PO2 of 57. A relatively healthy left upper pulmonary vein is having a saturation of 98 with a PO2 of 138. So the QP by QS now increases to 1.4:1. The PVRI still is 8.67. The pressures already I showed the trace. The basal PA pressure was 95/40 with a mean of 60. And the aortic pressure was 115/60 with a mean of 85. So there is a systolic difference of 20 millimeters of mercury. The diastolic pressure difference is 60 and 40. Not too much a fall in pressure on oxygen. If it is a hypoxia-driven pulmonary arterial hypertension, we should have got a good reduction. So that good reduction is not happening. So now the question, there is a disproportionate pulmonary arterial hypertension to the quantum of shunt. The quantum of shunt is only 1.2:1. So then is the PAH due to hypoxia? If it is due to hypoxia, then there should be a good response to oxygen, but there is only a minimal response to oxygen here. The PO2 improved from 69 to 90, saturation improved from 91.7 to 96.1, aortic saturation. So it is not completely getting reversed. So then the question, is it the BSD that was responsible? So has the patient developed pulmonary vascular disease already? The basic shunt is 1.2. It's minimally increasing to 1.4 on oxygen. So the PA diastolic pressure to aortic diastolic pressure in the basal state was 0.66 and it reduced to 0.45 on oxygen. Many of the criteria are not satisfied. PA diastolic to aortic diastolic pressure on vasodilator testing is 0.45, not adequate. Absolute PVRI on oxygen is 8.7, not adequate. The QP by QS on oxygen is 1.4, not. Many things will indicate inoperability, but the problem is confounders. Two factors are now acting together. One is the VSD and second is the lung disease. So now a balloon occlusion of this VSD is performed. Aortic systolic pressure of 115 increases to 126. Aortic pressure is maintained rather and marginally goes up. The pulmonary artery, RV systolic pressure, we are measuring the right ventricle through the sheath. RV systolic pressure, which was originally 95, came down to 53, thereby indicating a substantial amount of pulmonary hypertension is indeed caused by the VSD, even though the hemodynamic numbers are not able to clinically differentiate. When we saw the earlier slide, the PVR-SVR ratio is still more than 0.3. Absolute PVR index is still more than 0.6, more than 6. The PA diastolic pressure to aortic diastolic pressure ratio is still more than 0.45. So multiple numbers which indicate inoperability. However, in the presence of additional confounder like a lung disease, many of these numbers will not be making complete sense, and this is the place where you may have to use clinical discretion. So lung disease increases PVR, PVR reduces the shunt. Unilateral lung pathology can act on both the lung vasculature. Why? There is something called neural crosstalk. You can have a pathology isolated to only one lung, but the other lung can go into significant pulmonary arteriolar vasospasm due to what is called neural crosstalk. There are various circulating vasoconstrictive amines that are released by a hypoxic lung, which will cross over in the circulation to the other lungs, thereby causing elevation of vascular resistance on the other side as well. Hypoxia on any side will perpetuate pulmonary hypertension. So decision on operability sometimes will not be very easy only on calculations. Temporary shunt occlusion sometimes may give a clue. So the rule in operability in general will be no clinical desaturation should be present when you decide to operate. However, if there is desaturation, there should be an explainable lung disease. And if there is an exercise desaturation, again, there should be an explainable lung disease. Otherwise, patient should be fully saturated. I'll just give another scenario for a PDA. The previous one was for a VSD. A 27-year-old male diagnosed to have a large PDA in early childhood has got very frequent VZ bronchitis, asthma, is permanently on regular inhalers of steroids and dilators. He was evaluated, found to have systemic desaturation, but both in upper limb and lower limbs. Both upper and lower limbs have 90 to 91% saturation. There is no differential cyanosis. It's a uniform hypoxia. However, because of the hypoxia and a large PDA, he was diagnosed as early Eisenmenger syndrome and started on sildenafil along with his inhalers of steroids and bronchodilators. He has moderate tricuspid regurgitation. RV systolic pressure was 120 plus RA. Peak PR was 86. Echo showed a large 20 millimeter window-like PDA, but with predominant left-right shunt, and the saturations were 91% in both upper limb and lower limb. Echocardiogram showed that there is a left-right shunt, but it is laminar. That means there is no velocity between the left and the right. Iota and the PA, both are the same. Peak pulmonary regurgitation is 83 millimeters of mercury, and end diastolic PA pressure is more than 4 meters per second. That means it is more than 64 millimeters of mercury. So there is substantial elevation of PA diastolic pressure as well. So now you are taking the patient into the cath hemodynamics. The only finding is left ventricle is still dilated. Left ventricular dilatation in a large PDA might indicate that there is still a left ventricular volume overload. But I mentioned during the slide on echocardiogram, the left ventricular dimensions not only are dependent only on the shunt, but also on the myocardial function and on AV valve and semilunar valve regurgitations. And hence, left ventricular volume alone is not taken in isolation. So your cath hemodynamics is done. There is a 10% step up in the pulmonary artery. Puncture the pulmonary vein and enter in intraatrial septum and enter into the pulmonary vein. There is no step down from pulmonary vein to descending aorta. So there is no right to left shunt at all. But there is a 10% step up. This 10% step up, since it is happening at a low level, see 60% to 70%, will give only a small shunt. The reason why it is so is because this is on the vertical limb of the oxygen dissociation curve. So if suppose there is a 10% step up from 60 to 70, the QP by QS elevation will be minimal. On the contrary, if the saturation 10% step up is from 85 to 95, there will be a torrential shunt. So the lower and lower your SVC and IVC saturation, even a 10% step up will give only a smaller shunt. So this is 1.5 is to 1 shunt. Look at the aortic pressures and the pulmonary artery pressures. There is almost equal diastolic and mean pressures. So the PVRI calculator was 11.58. The PVRI calculator was 18.9. And PVRI by SVR ratio was almost 0.7. Pressure trace between the two, we are finding that almost both are equal. I told the patient is having an obstructive airway disease. So there is a pulsus paradoxus. An increased intrathoracic pressure excursion is transmitted onto both aorta and PA. And so there is a wide fluctuation. So there is a pulsus paradoxus caused by the airway disease. On oxygen, the step up improves. So from 75, 65 in SVC and IVC, it goes up to 89. So there is a larger step up. So the larger step up gives a QP by QS of 2.7. The PA diastolic and aortic diastolic remain the same because I mentioned it's a large PDA. So there is a diastolic equalization. But aortic systolic pressure goes up because LV stroke volume increases. Now the PVRI by SVRI ratio falls down to 0.3. So the PVRI by SVRI ratio falls even though the diastolic pressure ratio does not fall. Now this is the on oxygen. There is a equalization still of the diastolic pressure, but systolic pressure has got separated. You do a test balloon occlusion and there is a good separation. Aortic pressure goes up, pulmonary artery pressure goes down. Maintain the occlusion for a longer period, pulmonary artery pressure significantly falls, aortic pressure significantly gets elevated. Even though some of the data were not fitting in. For example, PA diastolic to aortic diastolic ratios did not fit in. PA diastolic pressure did not come down to extremely low levels. The PA diastolic was still remaining at the end of oxygen, somewhere around 80 millimeters of mercury. In spite of that, balloon occlusion separates them out. So what is the summary? A large PDA since infancy, PDA perpetuates recurrent VC bronchitis and reactive airways. The patient gets into a chronic airway disease. Saturations become low due to the chronic airway disease. So the saturations are 91% even in the pulmonary veins. The PVRI is quite high, which goes up to 19.6 Wood units in the basal state, but there is a substantial reduction on oxygen to almost half, even though the PVRI absolute number is not coming less than 6 Wood units. The percentage reduction is much more than 20%. The PVRI by SVRI ratio comes down to 0.3. Diastolic pressure ratio did not differ. Balloon occlusion resulted in marked drop in the PA pressures. So certain criteria get satisfied, certain criteria does not get satisfied. This patient gets a PDA closure almost 10 years ago and remaining fine on follow-up. This is on follow-up where the PA mean pressure, this is the peak of PR. PA mean pressure is 34 millimeters of mercury. And if you look at the PA diastolic pressure, it is 2.5 meters per second. So roughly it will be around 25 millimeters of mercury. So there is a significant reduction compared to the aortic pressures. So the message is, in general, PVRI numbers more than 8 Wood units is considered completely inoperable and less than 6 Wood units is considered good case of operation. PVRI-SVRI ratio of less than 0.3 is considered good case for operation. But we need to consider in a patient who is having multiple confounders like associated lung disease, sometimes some of the PVRI can be caused by the coexistent lung disease. So all these numbers that were initially described were pertinent to patients who do not have multiple associations. Now we are coming to the third common disease, AV canal disease. AV canal disease is commonly associated with trisomy, and so we are going to discuss issues with trisomy now. Shunt in AV canal defect can be dependent or obligatory. Dependent is what is established by around 2 months. Caused by progressive fall in the fetal PVRI. Sometimes it is accentuated in patients due to LVOT, gooseneck deformity, mild narrowing, and also in some patients with borderline unbalanced AV canal defect where there is a hypoplasia of the LV, shunt will increase. So this is a dependent shunt. It can sometimes be obligatory shunt established very early at birth itself. What is LV to RA shunt due to a cleft of the anterior mitral leaflet, or sometimes RV to LA shunt due to a cleft of the right-sided AV valve. An abnormal AV valve can result in an obligatory shunt due to TR or MR directed towards the wrong chambers. So the shunts can be dependent on variety of factors. Down syndrome is a common association. Since they get frequent respiratory tract infections, they are frequently exposed to hypoxia that perpetuates PAH. Down syndrome has got a reduced pulmonary vascular tree. The smaller pulmonary vascular tree itself perpetuates high PA pressure. especially when high systolic pressure from the VSD is transmitted onto the small pulmonary vasculature, more endothelial damage happens and so more pulmonary vascular disease. Airway is also hypoplastic in these patients. Starting from the nostril up to trachea, all the airways are smaller. And obstructive sleep apnea can be there in these patients, and pulmonary vascular response can be abnormal in these syndromic children. Variety of reasons why pulmonary vascular resistance can go up substantially in patients with Down syndrome. And so many children with Down syndrome may not get into heart failure. It is important to do a PV sampling to exclude physiological right to left shunt due to hypoventilation in a child who is going for a cath, especially with Down syndrome. So PV sampling is important. Hypoventilation will produce PV desaturation, and this hypoventilation will be corrected with oxygen supplementation, and oxygen supplementation so will correct the PV hypoxia. So the physiological right to left shunt will be corrected with oxygen. Similarly, the anatomical right to left shunt will also be corrected with oxygen. Whenever there is a high PVR, there will be an anatomical right to left shunt, which will be associated with high PA diastolic pressure to aortic diastolic pressure ratio. And if you give oxygen in this patient, the PVR will fall, and the fall in the PVR will result in a reduction in the anatomical right to left shunt. So when you give oxygen to these patients, there is not only a reduction of the physiological right to left shunt, but also anatomical right to left shunt. And it is so important to always sample the PV to identify how much is the right to left shunt anatomically and physiologically. The precautions that need to be exerted in children with Down syndrome especially are, we need to have optimal sedation to achieve proper hemodynamics, preferably conscious sedation. So after getting the vascular access and putting the catheters in the appropriate chambers, wait for the child to come out of the effect of sedation till the child reaches the first blood gas value of PCO2 of 35 to 45, pH of 7.35 to 7.45, and pulmonary vein sample showing PO2 of more than 90. That means the child is in appropriate sedation with adequate ventilation, and then start the hemodynamics. Waiting longer may be needed in Down syndrome for achieving this so-called steady state hemodynamics. Frequent need for mechanical ventilation will be there in these patients because of sedation-induced apnea. And if we are giving mechanical ventilation, ventilate with FiO2 of 21 to 25% in order to get the basal data. But we need to understand, when you are giving mechanical ventilation, you are having a little altered hemodynamics. Special situations in left to right shunts with left-sided obstructive lesions. Classical examples are shunts with obstructive lesions. For example, left heart obstruction will lead to pulmonary venous hypertension, and pulmonary venous hypertension will cause post-capillary pulmonary hypertension. Shunt lesions like a VSD or a PDA will cause circumferential vessel stretch and endothelial shear stress and cause pre-capillary pulmonary hypertension. So shunt causes pre-capillary pulmonary hypertension. Left heart obstruction causes post-capillary pulmonary hypertension. The relative contribution by each is difficult to quantify. Common associations are mitral stenosis with VSD and coarctation with PDA. A patient of 13 years with PDA and coarctation. A tight coarctation. You are able to see a tight coarctation and a large PDA. So now, in this particular patient, suppose if you go and correct this coarctation, correction of coarctation will improve the post-capillary pulmonary hypertension. But any correction of coarctation can only be done by closing the PDA, because surgical coarctation relief can only be happening with PDA closure. Suppose, let us assume we have closed the PDA. This particular patient, if the pulmonary hypertension has progressed to pulmonary vascular disease, closure of the duct during coarctation will lead to suprasystemic PA pressure and RV failure. Let us study the hemodynamics of this patient. The PA saturation is 83.2. Mixed venous saturation is 75. So there is a 7 to 8% step up. So there is a left-right shunt of 1.5:1. The left atrium, the pulmonary vein, the interatrial septum was punctured to enter into the left atrium. Left atrium is 98.3, ascending aorta is 98.4, and not much of desaturation. 98.4 in the ascending aorta, 97.3 in the descending aorta. So PDA is primarily shunting predominantly what left to right only. 1.5:1 left to right. Not much of right to left. Look at the coarctation hemodynamics. 100 millimeters of mercury difference between aorta, ascending aorta and descending aorta. So definitely coarctation needs to be released. But pulmonary artery pressure is very high. Pulmonary artery pressure is much higher than the descending aortic pressure. Pulmonary artery is 150, whereas the descending aorta is 122. So pulmonary artery pressure is substantially high. Pulmonary artery mean pressure is higher than the aortic descending aortic mean pressure. So the PVRI, indexed PVRI, is 22 Wood units. The PVR by SVR ratio is 0.6. High PVR index, very high PA pressures. PA diastolic pressure is actually higher than aortic diastolic pressure. So definitely correction of coarctation by surgery, unclosing the PDA, which has to be done with every surgery, is not going to be acceptable. So you have a patient who is having 13 years with severe pulmonary hypertension. PVRI is 22 Wood units. PVR-SVR ratio is 0.7. Symptomatic due to severe coarctation. Surgical relief of coarctation cannot be done by retaining the patency of PDA. If you close the PDA, you will lead to right ventricular failure. So what happened? The coarctation was relieved by a bare metal stenting. Now there is a question about, can descending aorta saturation be 97% if the PA saturation is higher? The descending thoracic aorta is getting supplied by both ascending aorta and pulmonary artery. The quantum of right to left shunt from the pulmonary artery into the descending aorta will decide how much of desaturation will be there. If most of the blood is crossing over through the coarctation from ascending aorta to descending aorta, the saturation will still be higher. I will show another example and explain this difference to you. So you can have pulmonary artery pressure being higher than the PDA, higher than the descending aorta, if the limb of communication between the pulmonary artery to descending aorta is relatively narrow, thereby not allowing a lot of PA blood to go into the descending thoracic aorta. So now coming back to the decision making, we decided that the PVRI and PVR-SVR ratio is quite high, that closure of the PDA may lead to RV failure. So this patient gets a coarctation relief by a bare metal stent, leaving the PDA completely open. So about 6 months later, you recatheterize the patient. You find the mixed venous saturation is now about 65 to 67%, which increases to about 73% on oxygen. Very minimal step up, which gives QP by QS of 1.25:1. Ascending aorta and descending aorta, as before, was more or less the same, with extremely minimal right to left shunt. Only the PO2 reduces from 91 to 80, but mostly the saturation is remaining mostly within 1%. So not much of right to left, but left to right is only 1.25. You give oxygen for 10 minutes and then recalculate, the QP by QS marginally increases. From a mixed venous of around 70, it increases to 80. So this QP by QS is now 1.55:1. The calculated PVR index is 29.1 and it reduces to 16.6. The reduction is inadequate. PVR still continues to be high. PVR by SVR ratio still continues to be more than 0.3. Look at the pulmonary artery pressures and aortic pressures. Since this is a large PDA, now through the side struts of the bare metal stenting, PA pressure and aortic pressure are almost similar. Pulmonary artery pressure continues to remain high. So a combined pre-capillary and post-capillary pulmonary hypertension, it was difficult to decipher the relative severity of each. In young patients, we can take a decision to go ahead and correct everything, thinking that in younger age will favor a remodeling of the pulmonary vasculature. For example, a newborn baby with a large PDA and severe coarctation with severe pulmonary hypertension, even when there is a differential cyanosis, is primarily corrected. Coarctation surgery with PDA division is done. But this was a patient who was 13 years. So in grown patients, PAH may not regress. We need to understand that in some patients who are having an obstructive lesion with a shunt lesion, PVR will always not reduce if you correct both. So sometimes you may have to correct only the obstructive lesion. So regarding the previous question that was being asked, like how can PA pressures be higher than descending aortic pressure but still not shunting? The lumen that is present between the pulmonary artery and the aorta in the ductus, if the lumen is primarily connected more towards the ascending aorta, the PA will not transmit a large amount of blood towards the descending aorta. So now this is another 2-year-old child with PDA and coarctation. Marked differential cyanosis. Ascending aorta is 92.6 and descending aorta is 66.2. Severe differential cyanosis. Look at the step up on the SVC to PA. SVC is 69.4, IVC is 40.9. Normally, IVC is higher than the SVC. But you have to remember, in the presence of severe differential cyanosis, ascending aorta is 92.6. So after supplying the upper part of the body, when it returns to superior vena cava, it is 69.4. And descending aorta is 66.2 because of the differential cyanosis. And after supplying the lower part of the body, when it comes back to inferior vena cava, it is 40.9. So the mixed venous saturation, there is hardly any step up to 60.4 in the PA. About the pressures, ascending aorta is 120/60 and descending aorta is 80/45. So there is a 40 millimeters of mercury coarctation gradient. PA here is suprasystemic. PA pressure systolic is higher than the descending aortic systolic pressure. In this particular patient, the PA is more in continuity with the descending thoracic aorta, that there is more amount of blood flow from the PA into the descending thoracic aorta, and that is causing this significant desaturation. But you look at this hemodynamics, the PA diastolic and PA mean are still marginally less than the descending aortic diastolic and mean. Still, this large systolic pressure difference is able to drive that amount of differential cyanosis. So what determines a differential cyanosis in the presence of coarctation with PDA is in which direction the PDA is more committed, whether it is PA to descending aorta or is it ascending aorta to PA, and this differs from PDA to PDA and depends on the difference in the coarctation shelf location. So again, since the descending thoracic aortic saturation is so low, what does the hemodynamic show? There is a marked differential cyanosis. Here I am not calculating QS. The reason is I am having two different values. Ascending aorta is 92.6. Descending aorta is 66.2. Two different values for ascending aorta. So we will not be able to calculate what is the QS here. So QS is not calculated. There was a question, how will you take the QS? QS is not calculated. I am intentionally not showing the calculation here because based on oximetry principles, you cannot calculate QS in this particular patient. As the descending aortic saturation is low, IVC saturation is also low than the SVC, which I explained. There is severe pulmonary hypertension and PA systolic pressure is higher than the aortic systolic pressure. descending aorta is perfused by and large by the PEA through the PDA. QES cannot be calculated due to different saturation. Again, the same strategy, stenting of the coarctation. This results in relief of the gradients. What happens to this hemodynamics after 6 months? So 6 months later, you restudy. There is not much of gradient across the coarctation, but now the PEA pressure has fallen down. How did it fall? The post-capillary hypertension part has been taken off, and the PDA being moderately restrictive, PA pressure falls. Now look at the QP by QS. Now we are able to calculate the QS because QS is equalized. The ascent, the aortic saturation is 96.2, both upper and lower limbs. So we can take aortic saturation correctly. So now the QS, the shunt is primarily left to right, with the QP by QS of 1.9:1, because from a mixed venous saturation of close to 68, it is going to 79.8. This gives a 1.9:1 left-right shunt with the PA pressure, which is subsystemic. So a decision is taken based on this QP by to go ahead and close the PDA. So the original severe coarctation with a large PDA, which is primarily committed to the descending aorta, was responsible for PA saturations to be transmitted to the descending aorta, so causing deep desaturation in the lower limb. Inadequate communication between the PA and aortic resulted the previous patient, the first patient that I showed, the 13 years, was having a larger communication between the ascending aorta to PA, whereas this patient is having a larger communication between the PA to descending aorta. The moment you go and stent the PDA, the large PDA still remains, but the post-capillary hypertension has been relieved, and finally the PDA gets closed with the duct occluder device through the struts of the stent. So, in small children, PA may undergo favorable remodeling, but it is unpredictable in older patients. Coming to, there is a question about IVC saturation still being low. How? It is not mandatory in every patient to have SVC saturation lower than the IVC saturation. SVC saturation depends on cerebral metabolism, and so in some cases, if the cerebral metabolism is low due to excessive sedation, then IVC saturation can be lower than the SVC saturation, or in other words, SVC saturation can go higher. So each and every saturation will depend on what is the metabolism. Now coming to combination of mitral stenosis with VSD, pre-capillary pulmonary hypertension is induced by large VSD, and post-capillary pulmonary hypertension is induced by mitral stenosis. PAH often regresses after relief of mitral stenosis. So many authors by anecdotal references will advise closure of the shunt and relief of mitral stenosis in every patient with this combination. In advanced age of the patient, the severity of pulmonary vascular disease may become unpredictable. However, this combination is mostly considered operable. Let me show an example of a mitral stenosis with VSD. You have a mixed venous saturation of around 69%, which is going to 78%. So there is some amount of step up of around 10%. There is a step down from 95.5 in the pulmonary vein to 93 in the aorta, 2.5% step down. So there is a small right to left shunt as well through this VSD. So the QP by QS is 1.4:1. With a right-to-left shunt that is small, but mostly a left-right shunt. And when you calculate the PVR index, the indexed PVR is 9.4 with a PVR-SVR ratio of 0.36. Let us look at the pressures. Because of severe mitral stenosis, transseptal puncture is made. Left atrial pressure is 36 against a right atrial pressure of just 3. PA pressure and aortic pressure are comparable. Not much of difference between the PA pressures and aortic pressures. Now, since there is a very significant pulmonary hypertension, if you are taking this patient is 14 and a half year old. If you are taking this patient for mitral stenosis relief by mitral valve replacement plus VSD closure, And in case this patient is having significant pulmonary vascular disease, you may fail to come off cardiopulmonary bypass, or you may come off cardiopulmonary bypass but will have pulmonary hypertensive crisis in the postoperative period, or sometimes have persistent pulmonary hypertension. If it is a young child, as I told you earlier, there is quite a lot of plasticity of the pulmonary vasculature, and hence you can take a chance to correct both together. But in a patient who is 15 years, the amount of pulmonary vascular disease is unpredictable. So you do an atrial septal stenting and completely relieve the left atrial pressure. So a left atrial septal stenting is done to make the atria communicate to right atria with a diameter of 18 millimeters. This brings down the PV pressure from 36 to 14 millimeters of mercury. So completely the mitral stenosis is relieved. If there is a relief of mitral stenosis, what should happen to the QP by QS? The pre-capillary pulmonary hypertension, the post-capillary element is now gone. So there should be an increase in the shunt. Look at the shunt now. A mixed venous of close to about 63 now increases to 83.5. There is a 20% step up. This results in QP by QS going up to 2.5:1. The moment the atrial septal stenting is done, the QP by QS increases enormously. The PVR by SVR ratio, the PVR index falls from 9.4 to 7.5. because the PA pressures are still remaining reasonably high because of the large VSD. And the PVR-SVR ratio becomes 0.36 to 0.26. Majority of the patients with mitral stenosis and VSD are basically congenital MS, like parachute mitral valve, double orifice mitral valve, mitral arcade, and hence this is not balloon mitral valvotomy. Balloon mitral valvotomy is applicable if you are having rheumatic mitral stenosis with congenital large VSD. We are talking about congenital large VSD with congenital mitral stenosis. Majority of them will be double orifice mitral valve, parachute mitral valve. And hence, way of relieving the left atrial hypertension will be non-invasively by atrial septal stenting. So what has created? The QP by QS has increased significantly, thereby indicating this patient is operable. So whenever there is a shunt with left heart obstruction, this comes as a special category, needs a careful clinical assessment. In general, younger the age, the patient is operable. If the right to left shunt is negligible, the patient is operable. More proximal the obstruction, like mitral stenosis, he is operable. More distal the obstruction, far away from the pulmonary veins, less operable, like in coarctation. Between proximal obstruction versus distal obstruction, proximal obstructions are favorable. Now we are going on to other lesions. TGA, tetralogy, admixture lesions, cyanotic lesions. Since the amount of hemodynamics in these are low, this will be able to complete faster. Hemodynamics of a transposition is pulmonary artery saturation higher than aortic saturation. Usually there is no real need for CAT study in a TGA to take oximetry, but there may be few exceptions. So there is a question, is this post-stenting pressures immediate or after a few months, instantaneous? What we are showing was the same CAT. Dr. Srija has pointed out, it's immediate pressures. Hemodynamics in a TGA. There is usually no need for acute hemodynamics, but there are few exceptions. TGA with reversed differential cyanosis. TGA with lower limb saturation higher than upper limb saturation. The causes are TGA with coarctation and PDA, or TGA with PDA with high pulmonary vascular resistance. TGA with PDA and high pulmonary vascular resistance, if the patient is already 6 months or 1 year with the reversed differential cyanosis, he is clearly inoperable, and so there is no need to operate. But TGA with PDA with high pulmonary vascular resistance in a newborn, that means TGA with PDA with PPHN. So we are coming to a focused subset, TGA with PPHN. Reverse differential cyanosis. This indicates PVR is higher than SVR. In such patients, arterial switch with high PVR carries higher risk, and hence allowing the PPHN to settle down will be useful. Reason why I am stressing on this, PPHN is relatively common in transposition in early neonatal period. Important to understand this. You will do septostomy in a patient with transposition of great arteries, and in post septostomy period, some of them do not increase their saturation dramatically due to PPHN. Now, I have to explain why PPHN happens. This is the fetal circulation. Left ventricle is pumping into the pulmonary artery, right ventricle is pumping into the aorta. We all know that in the fetal circulation, left ventricle carries higher saturation, right ventricle carries lower saturation because of preferential streaming of the blood from the ductus venosus towards the foramen ovale into the left atrium. So when a higher saturation left ventricle is pumping the higher saturation blood into the pulmonary artery, the higher saturation in the pulmonary artery lead to ductal relative constriction. This ductal relative constriction gives some amount of ductal resistance and so pushes more amount of blood to go into the lungs rather than a normal fetus. In a normal fetus, anywhere between 10 to 20% is pumped into the lungs, whereas in a TGA with fetus, because of the ductal constriction induced by this higher saturation, more amount of blood will go, and more amount of blood is actually going at systemic pressures because left ventricle and right ventricle are having same pressures. This systemic pressure now will induce some amount of pulmonary vascular changes in the pulmonary arteries. Since the larger amount of blood that is being pumped into the pulmonary artery is having a higher saturation, and since lungs do not utilize much of this oxygen, the pulmonary venous return is also high in its oxygen content. And so cumulatively, a higher content pulmonary venous return and a higher content foramen ovale flows put together will increase further and further the saturation in the left ventricle. This will cause progressive ductal constriction, progressive pulmonary vascular remodeling with more and more pulmonary artery musculature. So increasing pulmonary artery musculature is common in transposition due to this favored flow of blood from the pulmonary artery more into the lungs and less into the ductus. So PPHN is seen in about 12% of patients with transposition in early neonatal period. So once again, I will restate, this is a cartoon. Higher amount of oxygen saturation is coming through the pulmonary vein into the left atrium. Richly saturated ductus venosus blood is going through the fossa ovalis into the left atrium. Amount of ductal constriction. High oxygen saturation in PA dilates the pulmonary vasculature, leading to more and more blood that is going into the pulmonary arteries, which leads to more and more pulmonary venous return. And this increased pulmonary venous return will reduce the size of this PFO. So some of these patients will have restrictive PFO because of higher pulmonary venous return. The high PV oxygen will induce, again, high PA oxygen. This high levels of oxygen in the blood perfusing the duct will make it constrict so that the ductus becomes smaller. And if the ductus constricts, more left ventricle output will go through the lungs, leading to increased shear stress on the lung vasculature. This will increase the lung vascular musculature in the lung arterioles. So in transposition, persistence of hypoxia. If there is hypoxia, it's an indication for balloon septostomy and prostaglandin E1. And if you are having reverse differential cyanosis, it indicates PPHN, and you have to initiate treatment for it like oxygen, sildenafil, optimize the hydration and adequate ventilation in view of correcting this transient PPHN and make the child wait for about 7 days before this child goes in for corrective surgery, because PPHN will resolve over a period of time. There is a question about aortopulmonary collaterals. We will come to it in the next slide. why TGAs are prone for high PVR later. Aortopulmonary collaterals give hypoxic blood to the precapillary arterioles, thereby leading to arteriolar spasm. High pulmonary blood flow in any transposition will lead to high flows and high pressures, and hence that induces PAH. The PDA, if it is shunting left to right in a TGA, the hypoxic blood from the aorta will go through the PDA into the PA, and that hypoxia will also result in pulmonary arteriolar vasospasm. Shear stress and endothelial damage due to high amount of pulmonary blood flow. Platelet activation and destruction causing release of neurocirculatory amines. Polycythemia is inherent part of TGA, and polycythemia increases the vascular resistance. We have already seen in Poiseuille's formula. Microthrombi formation due to platelet activation. So transposition with VSD or a large PDA will develop pulmonary vascular disease in about 20% of the patients, even before 2 months, and 80% of the patients about 1 year of age. And transposition with pulmonary vascular disease with very severe hypoxia in advanced age will also become inoperable. So another indication for hemodynamics to be significant in a transposition. Even in transposition with intact ventricular septum, pulmonary vascular disease happens in less than 1% of patients before 2 months, 17% between 2 to 12 months of age, and 1/3 of the patients after 12 months of age. A transposition with intact ventricular septum beyond 12 months of age, a substantial number of patients will have already high pulmonary vascular resistance due to all these above said factors. Last component, transposition with a decompensated LV. You can do a catheterization to assess the LV pressure compared to RV pressure to use as a surrogate for assessing LV regression. But today, echocardiogram is reasonably good enough to identify this preparedness. So what is LV preparedness? Before birth, LV and LV have RV have similar pressures, and LV mass is equal to RV mass, but LV involutes rapidly due to fetal PVR because the pulmonary vascular resistance falls. So once the LV mass falls, it fails to pump against the systemic vascular resistance, leading to afterload mismatch after arterial switch, and that is called LV regression. How to identify unprepared LV? LV free wall thickness of less than 4 mm, LV mass less than 35 grams indexed, LV mass to volume ratio less than 2.5 gram per ml, LV shape changed banana, in IVS configuration with bowing to LV, LVSP predicted by MRJET, all these can be features of unprepared LV. And today it may not be needed to put in a catheter into the LV to assess the LV pressure to say that this patient has regressed LV. LV retraining strategies, sometimes done with ductal stenting, will give an opportunity to see the LV pressure. And if you are doing a ductal stenting, you should aim at increasing the LV pressure to more than 2/3 systemic, the LV pressure, in order to make the LV become prepared. There is a question, either restriction of PFO or restriction of PDA results in AP collaterals, especially restrictive PFO. We do see TGA after repair with endotracheal tube bleed, but no restrictive PFO preoperatively. Please explain. In fact, Rudolf explains transposition beautifully. One of the excellent books for reading transposition is Rudolf. Restriction of PFO is due to a specific reason. Whenever left ventricular output goes into the pulmonary artery, 80% of the blood normally goes through the ductus into the descending thoracic aorta, and only 10 to 20% goes into the pulmonary arteries. So a very small amount of only 10 to 20% comes back into the pulmonary veins, thereby causing relative underfilling of the left atrium. Left atrium primarily gets filled only through the patent foramen ovale from right atrium to left atrium. On the contrary, in certain patients with transposition of great arteries, if the high pulmonary artery saturation is causing pulmonary arteriolar dilatation in the fetus, the fetus allows more amount of LV blood to go through the pulmonary artery into the pulmonary arterioles, thereby increasing the pulmonary venous return. If the pulmonary venous return increases enormously in a transposition in the fetus, left atrial pressure increases, thereby pushing the primum septum towards the secondum septum and leading to restriction of the PFO. So restriction of the PFO is a sign of increased amount of pulmonary blood flow into the lungs in the fetus. While normal is 10 to 20%, if it goes to 30 to 50%, it will result in pulmonary venous return being very high and left atrial pressure increase. So restrictive PFO is a feature of high amount of blood in the fetal circulation going through the pulmonary arterioles rather than through the ductus arteriosus. Aortopulmonary collaterals are inherent part of transposition as a compensatory mechanism for maintaining oxygen saturation. So, huge amounts of bronchial collaterals develop in transposition and they lead to a large amount of shunt from the aorta to the pulmonary artery. We will not be able to assess this particular shunt because this is happening at pre-capillary level. So unless you are sampling at the level of pre-arteriolar level, you will not be able to get a lower saturation in the pulmonary artery. So PDA stenting, if you are using to retrain the left ventricle, you will get an opportunity to do left ventricular pressure assessment in a transposition, and if the LVSP by RVSP ratio is more than 0.65, this left ventricle is fit for arterial switch. Tetralogy of Fallot. Once again, tetralogy of Fallot is a condition where oximetry has minimal role. PA saturation is in general less than aortic saturation. Usually oximetry is not needed, but there are some exceptions. Tetralogy of Fallot with hypertensive PDA or AP collateral causing severe pulmonary hypertension, or tetralogy with aortic connection of one of the PA causing severe unilateral pulmonary hypertension. Tetralogy. This is an ascending aortic can be called as hemitruncus arteriosus or abnormal aortic origin of right pulmonary artery. So right pulmonary artery is at systemic pressures. Left pulmonary artery is fully protected. There is a severe pulmonary stenosis. Severe pulmonary stenosis, LPA is at low pressure. Ascending aorta is at high pressure. So this ascending aorta being at high pressure with abundant amount of pulmonary blood flow will result in preserved oxygen saturation that this patient does not present with significant cyanosis in early childhood. So these patients present at an advanced age where there is pulmonary vascular disease on the right lung and pulmonary oligemia on the left lung. How do you calculate the PVR? Right lung is having systemic PA pressures, left lung is oligemic. Right lung PVR can be calculated by aortic mean minus PV mean, because right pulmonary mean is same as aorta. Aortic mean mightly. Left PVR can be calculated by LPA mean by entering the left pulmonary artery and PV mean. But we should know left QP separately. How will you calculate right QP separately and left QP separately? We may have to use integration of various techniques like MRI for quantifying the right pulmonary vein return and left pulmonary vein return, and calculating individually right PVQP and left PVQP. Apply to the formula and get right PVR and left PVR. Put the right PVR in the formula R1 and put the left PVR in the formula R2 and get at total R and find out whether this R is within operable range. In general, in many centers in India, there are publications of this aortic connection of pulmonary artery on one side with tetralogy being corrected without any of these calculations based on one simple logic. If the left pulmonary artery is completely protected, if you do a connection between the right ventricle to the main pulmonary artery and connect both the pulmonary arteries together, blood will primarily go into the left pulmonary artery because the left pulmonary artery is already protected so high that it does not allow the right pulmonary artery. Am I audible to all of you? Hello?
Yes, sir. Please continue.
Okay. So majority of the centers do practice simple correction RV to PA if the PA pressures are low, accepting that one lung which is having high pulmonary vascular resistance may not have significant vascularity in the postoperative period at all. In fact, those publications do state that they will put a competent valve in order to avoid postoperative significant pulmonary vein, postoperative significant pulmonary regurgitation. PV saturation is uniformly the same. PV saturation is not independent to right lung and left lung. All the PVs will be equally be saturating in this particular pathology. So, exactly, as another person has pointed out, there is no neural crosstalk in some patients. In some patients, there is a neural crosstalk. What is neural crosstalk? Let me make it again clear. If suppose there is a patient with isolated aortic origin of right pulmonary artery, and the main pulmonary artery is continuing only into the left pulmonary artery, some newborns and some infants will have systemic left pulmonary artery pressure. Why did the left pulmonary artery pressure increase in that particular patient? It was because the entire right ventricular cardiac output was transmitted to left pulmonary artery, that the left pulmonary artery got a higher shear stress and circumferential stretch. So that was one factor. The second factor was neural crosstalk and circulatory amines from the other lungs, the other lung being fed completely by the ascending aorta. So in such a case, there is neural crosstalk. What I showed as an example was a tetralogy with the hemitruncus, wherein right lung is at systemic pressures, whereas left lung is protected by the tetralogy. So in such a case, ideal way of calculation is by using separately R1 and R2. I mentioned how to calculate R1 and R2 based on these principles, combining MRI with cardiac catheterization and arriving at the final number. As I told you earlier, if you are putting a competent pulmonary valve and directing right ventricular blood to go into one of the protected pulmonary artery, a single lung will be good enough in accepting the entire pulmonary blood flow as in a single lung ICR, and hence majority of the patient will have a reasonably good outcome, but they will all have postoperative moderate pulmonary arterial hypertension. Another indication for hemodynamics in tetralogy is massive collaterals. This is a massive collateral that is coming from the descending thoracic aorta, which is feeding the central pulmonary artery. And this massive collateral is maintaining the pulmonary artery pressure at systemic level. In which case, how will you do a calculation? The QP will be PA saturation and aortic saturation are the same. So the QP is calculated based on either the PA saturation or the aortic saturation, both being the same. QS is calculated, PVR is calculated, PA mean and aortic mean is the same. PVR by SVR ratio is calculated, and basic principles of CATH are applied. And if the patient is having an acceptable PVR, acceptable PVR to SVR ratio, go ahead and correct these patients. If the patient is having high PVR, high PVR SVR ratio, leave the patient as pulp. Tetralogy, large AP collateral with pulmonary vascular disease. There is a question about single lung ICR can lead to PAH. Yes, all single lung ICR will result in mild to moderate elevation of pulmonary artery pressures, and that is part of every single lung ICR. Coming to admixture lesions, we'll go a little faster from now. Admixture lesions, in general, if you assume mixed venous saturation is 70% and pulmonary vein saturation is 100%, in an ideal single ventricle, aorta will be equal to pulmonary artery. And going by the calculations, saturation is 85% means QP is equal to QS. If the saturation is 80%, that means QP is less than QS. And saturation is 90%, QP is more than QS. So this is like a simple rule. But this is in a very, very compensated patient. Now the child is very sick, then mixed venous saturation may go down to up to 15. So the QP by QS will be 1:1 if it is saturation is 75%, and QP by QS will be 0.5 if it is 67% saturation. QP by QS will be 2 if it is 83% saturation. So you need to do this shortcut calculations depending on how well the child is or how sick the child is. Admixture lesions, we have to calculate QS, QP, QEP. Based on QEP, find out right to left shunt, which is QS minus QEP, and left to right shunt, which is QP minus QEP. How these are derived has already been dealt with yesterday in detail. There is something called a streaming in bidirectional shunts. Streaming means whether the aorta and pulmonary artery saturations are marginally different. In general, tetralogy has got something called favorable streaming, wherein PA saturation is always less than aorta. Transposition has got unfavorable streaming, wherein aorta is always less than PA. And if there is a complete admixture, as in tricuspid atresia or pulmonary atresia, aorta is always equal to PA. Admixture physiology can be at various levels. Atrial level, TAPVC, common atrium, tricuspid atresia, mitral atresia. Ventricular level, single ventricle DORV, or VSD with pulmonary atresia, VSD with aortic atresia. And great arterial level is truncus arteriosus. All common atriums have got favorable streaming. Always PA saturation will be less than the aortic saturation. If the patient is having very significant cyanosis, think that this patient may have an LSVC that is draining into left side of the common atrium, causing more desaturation. So in a common atrium, usually it is like a large ASD with very mild desaturation. If there is more amount of desaturation, then LSVC should be suspected. Tricuspid atresia and mitral atresia has got complete admixture. So often PA saturation and aortic saturations are completely normal. So in a tricuspid atresia, if the systemic saturation is equal to 85%, that means QP is equal to QS. There was a question that was asked. In a tricuspid atresia with VSD with no pulmonary stenosis, the patient is having unprotected pulmonary blood flow and the child is presenting at around 2 years of age, how will you decide about operability? If the patient is well looking and if the saturations are more than 85%, 90%, 95%, that means QP is still higher than QS and it may be worthwhile going and banding that particular child in order to protect the pulmonary artery. Sometimes the banding will not be in order to create a bidirectional Glenn and Fontan, but just to control the QP by QS. So QP by QS can be deciphered by the quantum of saturation. Streaming in TAPVC, SVC type of TAPVC will have unfavorable streaming, IVC type of TAPVC will have favorable streaming, coronary sinus TAPVC will also have unfavorable streaming. Because in SVC and coronary sinus TAPVCs, the pulmonary veins that comes from the SVC and coronary sinus will largely go into RV and PA, thereby creating more saturation in PA. Whereas if it is an IVC type of infradiaphragmatic TAPVC, more amount of the pulmonary vein saturated blood will come through the IVC, will get directed through the fossa valleys into the left atrium and left ventricle, thereby causing aortic saturation being higher. So let us assume some more logics on TAPVC. If the saturation is 85% in a well child, QP is roughly equal to QS, and if saturation is more than 85%, it indicates high QP, and so this patient is operable even if there is echo evidence of severe PAH. If the saturation is less than 85%, then look for evidence of pulmonary vein obstruction. If there is a pulmonary vein obstruction, then there could be a post-capillary component for the pulmonary hypertension. And so, in pulmonary vein obstruction with saturations even less than 85%, go ahead and operate. Now coming to absence of pulmonary vein obstruction, but the child is young age, go ahead and operate, giving the benefit of doubt. In the absence of pulmonary vein obstruction in an older child, if the saturation is less than 85%, cath for hemodynamics PVR calculations. Now coming to streaming in DORV. Some of the questions that I am not able to follow, because some of the questions are not coming in context with what I am explaining. And so such persons can write to me separately so that I can again explain. However, if there is any question that is coming in the context of what I am explaining, I am taking it immediately. Streaming in double outlet right ventricle, subaortic VSD has got favorable streaming. Apply the same principles as what we will do for VSD operability. That means large heart, plethora, saturation more than 92%, flow mid-diastolic murmur in the mitral area, volume overload of left ventricle, they are all operable. Subpulmonic VSD, tossic being, always there will be unfavorable streaming where aortic saturation is lower than the PA saturation. Apply the same principles as transposition. So tossic being in small baby, 2 month, 3 month is clearly operable. Tossic being in more than 1 year, high chances of vascular disease. Streaming in single ventricle, L malpost aorta will have favorable streaming and D malpost aorta will have unfavorable streaming. Streaming in truncus arteriosus, usually it is a complete admixture, but some cases will have favorable streaming. Again, in truncus arteriosus, if the systemic saturation is equal to 85%, that means QP is roughly equal to QS in a well child. And if the saturation is more than 85, QP is more than QS and they are operable. So this is all with an assumption that the mixed venous saturation is 70%. And so the child should be well looking on clinical examination. Univentricular heart. The criteria for doing a bidirectional Glenn-Shunt, there is a question. In case of TAPVC saturation, in all chambers will be the same, then how to calculate PVR? TAPVCs, if it is a complete admixture, all the chambers means it's the pulmonary artery and aorta will have the same saturation. It is not all each and every chamber. It is a pulmonary artery and aorta will have the same saturation. So the calculation of PVR will be based on absolute PA pressure, absolute PV pressure. You need to sample the PV in the common chamber. You need to sample the superior vena cava in a place where the TAPVC is not drained. For example, if the coronary sinus TAPVC or a cardiac TAPVC or infracardiac TAPVC, the usual superior vena cava. But if it is a supracardiac TAPVC, then that superior vena cava has to be sampled well above the innominate vein, something like in the jugulars and all, in order to find out what is the SVC saturation and take the IVC saturation and go for clamp formula. Coming back to case selection for bidirectional Glenn-Shunt, pulmonary artery pressure of less than 15, transpulmonary gradient of less than 6, diastolic pulmonary gradient of less than 3, ventricular end diastolic pressure of less than 12, all these four are indicators of operability. All these four do not use QP, do not use VO2. Additional criteria, PVRI less than 4 Wood units. Here, you are including VO2. You are including QP calculation. So VO2 independent only pressures and VO2 dependent, you have to take PVRI. So the QP, for calculating the QP, you need to go back to VO2 derived by pneumograms. So criteria for selection of PDG, if you are using only pressure criteria, you can do them without any VO2. But if you are using PVRI criteria, then obviously you have to go to VO2 and calculate the QP. After bidirectional Glenn, when in a pre-Fontan situation, how will you do the calculations? Pediatric cardiology residents, pay a little bit of concentration here. I'll explain slowly. Q superior vena cava is QP. Whatever comes from the superior vena cava goes into the pulmonary artery, so that is QP. QSVC is QP. cardiac output, that is QS, is combination of what comes back from the pulmonary vein and what comes back from the inferior vena cava. So what comes back from the pulmonary vein, it is QP. And what comes back from the inferior vena cava, it is QIVC. So cardiac output is QP plus QIVC. So always QS is QP plus QIVC. Since in a small child, QP is QSVC. In a small child, SVC is roughly equal to IVC. QS will be roughly 2 times QP. But as the patient gets older and older and older, SVC component will become much smaller, IVC component will become much larger. So, proportionately, QP will become less and less, and cardiac output will primarily be QIVC. This is what is called outgrowing the bidirectional glen shunt. So, cardiac output is QP plus QIVC. How will you calculate QP? QP is simple formula, VO2 by PV oxygen content minus SVC oxygen content. SVC or PA, both are the same. So, easy to assess PV, so PV oxygen content. Easy to assess SVC, so SVC oxygen content. So, QP is calculated precisely. Now, what about QS? QS is actually derived from not only the PV but from the inferior vena cava as well. Now, what is QS formula? Aortic saturation minus mixed venous saturation. Here, the blood that was pumped out from the aorta is returning back both from superior vena cava and inferior vena cava. But we are now taking inferior vena cava alone. So let us put first that VO2 by aortic oxygen content minus inferior vena cava oxygen content. But what we have forgotten is this is not mixed venous. There was a substantial amount of blood that came from the superior vena cava, which is not too much different from the inferior vena cava in terms of saturation. Both of them more or less will be the same. However, we have ignored this. While in using the FLAM formula and all, we gave a lot of importance to superior vena cava. Here we are giving a lot of importance only to inferior vena cava. So there needs to be a correction factor. So the correction factor is the difference between the pulmonary vein oxygen content to inferior vena cava oxygen content divided by pulmonary vein oxygen content to superior vena cava oxygen content. So cardiac output or QS in a patient post bidirectional glen shunt is VO2 divided by aortic oxygen content minus inferior vena cava oxygen content. You have to give a correction factor, PV oxygen content minus IVC oxygen content by PV oxygen content minus SVC. This correction is given for nullifying the effect of not using the mixed vein and only the inferior vena cava. Majority of the time in practical clinical purposes, inferior vena cava alone is taken and the QS is calculated. It does not make too much of error because SVC and IVC saturation will more or less be the same. Fortunately, one more advantage is QS is not of any relevance in calculating the PVRI. And so whether we calculate the QS or whether we don't calculate the QS, a post-glen is significantly affected. But in case if you are calculating the QS, then you have to calculate using the correction factor. So QIVC will be cardiac output minus QP. So basically, cardiac output is QP plus QIVC. SVR is calculated by aorta minus RA by QS, same formula. PVR is calculated by PA minus PV by QP, same formula. Since QP is calculated relatively simply by taking saturation of the PV and taking saturation of the superior vena cava, QP is mostly correct. Yesterday I mentioned to you, when we are calculating the QP, some of the pulmonary veins will be carrying more and more of desaturated blood due to pulmonary AV malformation. Some of them may not have an AV malformation, and so sampling, when you are doing, try to do it on multiple pulmonary veins in order to assess and localize where is the pulmonary AV malformation, number one. Number two, whichever pulmonary vein is lowest will indicate that is the site where the maximum amount of pulmonary AV malformations are present. And so the Fontan should primarily concentrating on directing the hepatic blood flow towards that particular segment. So it is primarily for localizing, but for calculations, take the highest PV saturation, whatever you have obtained. You may get a confusion about why you don't average. If there is a pulmonary AV malformation that has caused a desaturation in one of the pulmonary veins, that is actually not truly QP. The QP means what goes through the pulmonary capillaries and comes back. So if there is a, let us assume, only a localized left lower lobe pulmonary AV malformation, lower lobe alone will have a desaturation. Forget about the desaturation. If you are taking the correct oxygen saturations, the highest oxygen saturation in the best PV, you will be calculating the real QP. And what you have missed out by the pulmonary AV malformation sector will actually result in finally a lower saturation in the aorta, and this final lower aortic saturation will go down through the upper limb circulation and finally come through the superior vena cava as a proportionate hypoxic blood, and so that will get nullified. So sample all the four pulmonary veins if possible in a bidirectional gland. Use it for localizing segments with pulmonary AV malformation and excluding pulmonary AV malformation, and take the highest pulmonary vein saturation as your QP calculations. Requisites for Fontan surgery, same sort of criteria, PA pressures, TPG, diastolic pulmonary gradient, ventricular end diastolic pressure, all these are pressure-based criteria. Only one is cardiac index based criteria or VO2 based criteria. In a pre-Fontan assessment, in order to avoid this VO2 assumption, cardiac MRI is sometimes used, wherein pulmonary vein return is calculated by phase velocity imaging and QP is calculated from MRI. A jugular cannula is inserted to find out the Glenn pressure, to calculate the PVA pressure by direct insertion of a cannula into the Glenn circuit. But in many centers which do not routinely use MRI for routine calculations, standard cath is done before a Fontan surgery as a routine. So coming to the last, what we discussed till now is basic principles of oximetry and FIC principle, VO2 assumptions and methods of measurement, understanding cardiac output and oxygen extraction, calculation of QP, QS, QEP, PVR, SVR, decision about operability of individual lesions, cath in specific lesions, what exactly to look for, and role in cyanotic lesions. Summarizing today's session only, we started with pre-tricuspid lesions, then post-tricuspid lesions, concentrated on AVCD with special mention to Down syndrome, shunts with left heart obstructions, special use in transposition, and special use in tetralogies when there is segmental hyperperfusion by IP collateral or anomalous aortic connections, admixture lesion explaining what is streaming, and how to evaluate for Glenn and Fontan surgery. So, if there are specific questions, please send them on an email or WhatsApp after clearly identifying who you are so that I can reply. It's a quite a vast topic, and hence it is, in spite of taking close to about 5 hours, still some concepts may not be fully be clear, and we can discuss it either on an email or on a chat. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, sir. Can I end the meeting too?
Sure.